No Jumper, coolest podcast in the world. Today we're here with
XXXTentacion.
See, I'm making you say your own name because it's. I've been looking at it online for the past few months, and I didn't really know how to say it. But hey, man, it's nice to have you in the studio.
I appreciate it, brother. Thank you.
And I guess you should. Well, we got No Jumper alumni Craig Zen over here on the left. Maybe you should introduce your homie.
All right, we got Craig Zen, we got Lil Weefy, Lil Buddha Wife, you feel me? We got Lil Buddha. Gabe, Young Dirty Dick on the beat, you feel me? You got Skeet Mask, the Slunk Guy, we got Bruno Dicker down in the corner, you feel me? And then we got Adam from No Jumper.
Adam from No Jumper, what's poppin'?
Jewel.
Yeah, we out here. Yeah, so I guess we should start with the basic information. Where are you from?
I am from, all right, so I gotta get in depth, so, all right, how I put it? I was raised borderline like Pompano, but I was born in Plantation Hospital, raised around Pompano area, raised around North Lauderdale and Broward. Like, so Broward County was like where I grew up. So then after a while, like, I got kicked out of like a lot of schools. So I ended up going to like Deepside or Lauderhill.
Okay.
And then I lived throughout like Lauderhill for like a lot of my life after I got arrested.
So what kind of environment are these in? And for people who don't know, he's talking about Florida.
Lauderhill is like the hood. Lauderhill is like. Like, niggas call it four-way. Like, you throw a four-way like this. Like,
well, what's this mean?
It's the four-way, like, it's like...
Four-way.
Yeah, four-way, the block.
Deep side.
From the, yeah, deep side. From the
okay.
Block. Like, type shit, like...
Clearly, I'm out of the loop on this.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just Broward shit, like...
Yeah.
Like, bro, yeah.
How old are you?
I don't say my age.
You don't like say it?
Yeah, I don't say much about myself, because, like, I feel like everybody tries to judge me as far as knowledge-wise. I feel like the younger you are, or however you say you are, like, niggas feel like they have something over you, feel me? Like, I don't let anybody little bro me at that.
Okay.
So I just don't like to speak about my age because people try and use my age to determine my knowledge.
Okay. Little bro you. I hear a lot of people say that terminology these days.
Yeah.
They're like, oh, he's trying to little bro me.
Yeah.
You ever had this happen to you?
Nah, because, like, I just fade niggas.
Why, nah. You're a fighter? You've been getting a lot of fights?
Bro, I've been fighting since I was a kid.
Fuck.
Come close
to
me,
bro.
He knows. What, he's always been throwing the hands or what?
I mean, I've been there plenty of situations and like plenty of fights. Like, I knew him for 4 years. Yeah, we all know. Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. So okay, you grew up in the hood.
Type shit, yeah.
Type shit. All right. And so, what kind of upbringing did you have? Like, what's your mom like?
My mom is mean.
Poor mean.
My mom probably like. My mom's probably the only girl that could beat me up.
Really?
Yeah, probably.
What about Ronda Rousey?
Ronda Rousey? No, I'll throw hands with Ronda Rousey.
Okay.
That's good to know. Ronda Rousey. You can see me with the hands.
Well, no. she's coming off of L anyway, so you got an advantage.
Yo, that fight was epic, bro. That was
amazing.
Fucking fight.
Fantastic
crazy.
Experience, yeah.
All right, my mom.
Quick discussion of women's MMA.
Yo, I love MMA. I've actually met Tyrone Spong, Rashad Evans.
Nice.
Vitor Belfort.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, cool guys.
I love MMA too. It's so entertaining.
All fucking cool guys.
Yeah.
All right.
Your mom, though.
Yeah, my mom. My how do I put it? My mom is like the spit image of me, but like probably more, you know, pretty.
Okay.
She
doesn't have gold teeth though, right?
Nah. Nah, she low-key is the reason why I got gold teeth though. Like, my mom, when I was a kid, I like wanted me to get gold teeth.
She wanted you to when you were a kid.
Yeah, when I was a kid, she asked me, bro, like, asked me if I wanted gold teeth type shit.
What the fuck was wrong? Was it when Paul Wall was on the radio saying grills? Was it really?
Yeah. Yeah,
ludicrous.
Nah, because it's just where I was like, Pompano, bro, like niggas like Kodak, like bro, it was big on grills. Grills was a thing. Like, girls,
to be honest, in the South, grills is everything, to be honest.
Yeah, that is, bro.
What you need, it's like becoming a man. It's like getting, it's like losing your virginity once you're like 16 or so.
It's like becoming, it's like from boy to thug.
Yeah. That's when you hop off the porch, you start running around with a bunch of gold teeth. Yeah.
She just,
yeah.
Roll up on a nigga, you just
bring the mic. You're not gonna be able to hear.
And when you see like another nigga like just have gold in their mouth, and you just look at them like, damn, bro, he doing something right with his life.
You do look at them different for sure. I think Kodak wears it extremely well because you notice he got his own emoji just.
Yeah, his shits are perms though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
He's savage with it.
Shout out Kodak.
That's like the ultimate
Shout
level is when you get the permanent ones, right?
Yeah, the permanent ones where you just permanent thug.
You guys Kodak fans?
I'm a Kodak supporter.
Yeah.
I'm not a very like I can't use the word fan.
Fan for many people.
It's more of like I'm inspired by a lot of people. Like,
right.
I won't go and say like I don't listen to Kodak. I won't go saying like I listen to all these artists.
But we fuck with them.
Yeah, we fuck with them heavy. Sound. Just to call yourself a fan is like it's a support. Like when I tell my fans, if you're gonna be a fan, it's different than being someone that supports me.
Okay.
Because if you're a fan, that means you abide by everything that I believe in and that you support what I do to the fullest extent. Okay. If you support me, you're just like, oh, I see that nigga, he's grinding, you feel me? He's doing his thing.
Right.
And I'm going to support from this distance. But a fan is someone that, like, I feel like you have to be a core fan. Like, I have a cult fan base. I don't have, like, a weak-ass fan base. Like,
right.
I speak to my fans. I help my fans. Like, because I try and be in depth, you know?
Your shit is weird because you have a crazy-ass following on social media and stuff. And, like, it's not, like, necessarily the craziest, like, numbers, like 10,000 or whatever. Or how many you have on SoundCloud?
SoundCloud, I'm at
18.5. But, like, the numbers are retarded because it's, like, you really seem like... And just the number of people who have asked me to interview you is fucking insane. Like, yeah. Considering, you know, that you're, like, an underground artist. More, like, the number of tweets I had to read about you, man, are, like... I don't want kids out there to think that they should tweet at me about their friend 800 times, but... Yeah. You know, it does... Eventually, I notice at some point.
Yeah. Hell yeah. No, definitely a fucking cult fan base. Like, I definitely have a fucking cult fan base. I'm going to take this off.
Not into the headphones?
Yeah.
As long as oh, okay. Damn. Now, look, we can see the man now. Okay. Damn, everything off.
About to come out the shirt.
I was trying to hide myself type shit.
Fat Trell over
time,
here.
Every time, bro.
Well, it's hot, too.
We can't go nowhere.
The temperature is 76 degrees in here.
Yeah, it's
That's solid.
All right, so you feel me? We booted up. I came out the shirt type shit.
Drill music on deck right now.
Let's play some fucking walk.
This looks like drill music.
All right.
So, okay, we were just talking about your mom a little bit. She's mean. Tell me a little bit else.
All right, I mean, when I grew up with my mom, like, I mean, should I get in depth? Because my mom's the type of, like, girl, like, if I say too much, she'll get hot at me. Because it's still real life, you feel me, besides
yeah.
me.
I don't know.
I mean, I'm going to keep it 1,000. Like, if niggas want to judge me, they want to judge me. Like, I'll keep it to a minimum. Me and my mom went through it hard. Like, my mom was just in situations where she couldn't take care of me, you feel me? Like, niggas done drive-bys on me when I was, like, a jit type shit. Like I stabbed my first nigga a bit. Like, I bit out, like, basically a nigga tried to put his hands on my mom type shit.
And
like,
you were how young?
I was like six.
Stabbed him.
And
I
bit his flesh out and like grabbed the glass shard and like poked him with it type shit. Like stabbed him with it. Like,
wow.
And I was like 6, 7. Like
uh-huh.
My mom just had me like she was in a situation where like she wanted me around, but she couldn't afford to like because of shit she was around. You know, she was still growing up. Like my mom was raised in Jamaica.
But what was she around? Was she around a lot of like drug dealing and crime just, or like yeah. Why is she around motherfuckers that were beating her up and you got to stab them?
She just to put it in a simpler term, like my mom wasn't a prostitute or nothing, but like. She just wasn't in a very stable environment because she had no help at that. Like,
right.
My mom just had it hard, bro. Like, uh-huh. Honestly. She raising a kid, honestly, was on her last priorities. You feel me? So what she did was she passed me from hand to hand to people that could take care of me, you know?
Uh-huh.
And, like, doing that, like, I was put in situations that weren't the best, but I get what she was doing. So I don't resent her. I would never resent my mom, but, like, my mom had it hard. I had it hard. And it's just a very misunderstood. Like, my relationship is still being...
Mentioned. But you're really young to already have that acceptance of, like, looking at your mom and being like, I understand what you went through, and I know that it was hard, and I can forgive you for whatever I had to go through. But did you feel that way as a kid? Did you understand? Were you angry at her when you were, like, a little kid getting put in all these crazy situations?
I chased her, like... Bro, like, I remember I used to beat niggas at school type shit just to, like, hear my mom yell at me or talk to me.
What, just because you wanted some attention
just
from her?
Just because I wanted some attention, yeah. Like, I remember I used to go to, like, fucking Margate Middle. I remember one day, like, this bitch kept fucking with me. Like, and I don't say hit girls. I know this is not something that, but I'm going to, like, keep it 1,000 for me. I don't like to lie. There was, like, this bitch that kept slapping me at school type shit. So I remember, like, one day. I was like, all right, obviously it's a girl. She probably likes me or some shit, you know? So I went to my mom and I asked her. I was like, would you get mad if I slapped this bitch? And she was like, well, I didn't say it like that. I was like, would you get mad if, like, I put my hands on a girl? She's like, you always give a girl 3 warnings type shit. So, like,
that's what your mom told you?
Yeah, you always give a girl 3 warnings. And if she keeps hitting you, like, obviously she's trying to harm you.
Right.
So if she's trying to harm you, then you go to, like, to the extent to where you gotta handle it.
Uh-huh.
So I remember one day, like this girl and her boyfriend, like, were fucking with me at school, and I was like, cause I was making fun of them. And, like, I think she slapped me or some shit, and, like, I slapped the fuck out of her and kneed her. And I remember from after that, like, my mom realized how serious I took her. Like, her word was my bond.
Right.
You know? So, like, afterwards, like, anything she would say to me, I'd take it to heart. Like, if she would duck me, I'd take it to heart. Like, I remember one time she got mad, like, about some dumb shit and just said a lot of, like, hurtful shit. So, like, everything, like, I mean, to skip to the point, when I was a kid, like, I took everything she said to heart. I took my mom very seriously.
We always forget that, though, that kids take everything that we say completely literally. Because as adults, we are so used to sarcasm and, like, nuance in conversation, you know?
Literally.
But you just, yeah, that's crazy. But so, all right, so what kind of kid were you in school? You're acting like you were getting picked on and shit. Were you a little hard ass or were you a little nerd because you're kind of small?
I was a hard ass. Yeah. Like, how do I put it?
You were overcompensating?
I was overcompensating. I was, all right, how I put it? I was that kid that didn't say much, but, like, him not saying much made you want to know what the fuck he was thinking.
Uh-huh.
So I'd be, like, I'd be in the cut, and then when I'd say some shit, it'd be some weird shit. Like, I'd say some crazy shit, like, oh, I'm going to beat the fuck out of you or some shit. Like, I'd be the kid in the cut to, like, just get off on somebody type shit, and then you wonder why the fuck it happened. So you come to me, you speak to me, and want to get the inside of everything. Like, I never really spoke. I always acted. I mean, that was always my problem. I always acted before I thought anything through.
Were you, like, getting in trouble all the time, or were you kind of laying low?
I mean, part of, like, I spent a year in jail, bro. Like,
At what point in your life?
When I was like, how old, bro? I met him in fucking jail.
Yeah, really?
Yeah.
We met in jail.
What the fuck were you in jail for?
Man, I was in jail for a whole bunch of bullshit. A whole bunch of shit with my life, like selling weed, getting caught, like getting kicked out of school, a whole bunch of crazy shit.
And what did you go in for that time?
Fuck. All right.
A lot of shit.
Armed robbery.
What was that like?
No, it was gonna keep going.
Okay.
Armed robbery. And this is not me being cool. This is not me saying this shit is okay.
We don't condone this shit.
I was just fucking up, you know?
Allegedly.
Yeah.
No, if you already went to jail for it, then it doesn't have to be allegedly.
Armed robbery, armed burglary.
Possession of a firearm.
Armed burglary with dwelling, resisting without violence. Grand theft of three charges.
Yeah, he got a lot of charges.
Possession of oxycodone.
They was trying to direct filed his ass.
Yeah.
I seen all these charges. Like, I seen it. Like, we went to court.
I had the worst charges in the jail.
The judge read the charges to him, and I'm looking at this nigga like, what the fuck is little nigga is?
I don't even know where to start on that list, though. Like, and where to start? Like, why are you stealing cars, number one? Why are you selling all
these
pills?
No, it wasn't even cars. It was the amount of houses I robbed. Like, bro.
This was before face tats.
I was a little nigga, like, I was tiny, like, I had a fucking Wiz Khalifa patch in my head, like, bro, I looked like a little bitch, you feel me?
But you
like,
were getting it in.
Yeah, but bro, I was dead ass, like, ask any nigga around me, like, I was a young savage, I was a little savage, like.
Okay, but were you trapping, like, were you actually, making money, or were you, like, just fucking doing a bunch of crazy ass shit, getting in trouble?
What it was is, like, all right, I told my mom, like, one day, because, like I said, I was always after my mom, like, I always wanted her attention. So I told my mom one day, I was like, if you want me to do anything, you need to be around. Because at this time, I lived with my grandma.
Right.
She kicked me out. Because basically, like, bro, there's a lot to the story with my mom. Like, my mom is a big part of my life.
Mm-hmm.
But I was fucking up. Basically, I got kicked out of middle school. And she put me in a behavioral correctional called Sheridan House. Mm-hmm. And shouts out to Sheridan House. Wonderful. It's called Sheridan House Family Ministries. It's actually located in Broward near Davie. But wonderful people, like, wonderful environment. Like, I enjoy what they were teaching me, you know? But,
How you get kicked out of middle school?
Yeah, kicked out of middle school, why? That's a good question. You're right. You're filling in the blanks,
What did I get? All right. There's a list of shit.
You did.
I remember I beat some niggas, I beat some niggas. Like, shouts out to him. I fuck with him now. We're cool now. I think his name's, like, Marcus or something.
But he only
has
one eye now?
No. His eye was good, but, like, I fucked his eye up type shit.
You gotta
fuck
it up again.
Yeah, there was this fat kid in my class that made fun of my mom. I kicked him in his mouth.
Oh, fat kid.
I fought some Chico nigga on the bus. Cause he said some shit like to my, like, when I was in middle school, bro, I was a little pimp. I'm not gonna flag. Like, I probably got more bitches than I get now. Like,
really?
I'm a loner now.
So
bro.
You're getting pussy from a super young age, or did it take a while for you to start getting bumps?
Oh my god, bro! Cause I was a pretty young nigga. Like,
they
my
love
mom,
a savage, don't
my
they?
Mom, my mom raised me like a little pretty bitch. Like, I was pretty. Like, I used to wear Aeropostale. Like, no, not Aeropostale. No. Let me get right. I used to wear Abercrombie. Like, Abercrombie and Hollister. You feel me? I was not.
Sounds like the third wrong version of Abercrombie. Yeah.
Yeah, like. Like, it's levels to that shit.
Yeah, yeah, it is, really. That, you're also the first person I've ever interviewed who holds the mic like he's performing with both hands on.
I don't know. Because my hands are fidgety, bro. Like,
oh, it's fine, yeah.
My hands are fucked. Like, I fucked like them up. I broke both of them. Like, both of my hands are broken as we speak.
Right. Damn.
So, like,
true fact.
Yeah.
True fact.
True fact.
Both your hands are broken from fighting, I'm assuming.
Yeah. True fact. Yeah.
Yeah, bro. Trust me.
So, you're still getting it in. Jeez. All right. Type shit. Let's keep going with where we're at in the story with you.
No games.
Getting kicked out of middle school or whatever. Kicked
the shit out of somebody in Texas.
I did stop a nigga in Texas.
Shout out Wi-Fi's funeral over here with no mics, flexing on the bike. You're gonna be able to see that in the shot
look,
a little bit.
Man,
cool.
I'm gonna tell you like this. This is how it happened. All right, so look, we in the convenience store, right? And it's one little white.
Come closer to the mic, nigga.
A little closer to the mic.
He looked like a little hipster or whatever, whatever. A nigga comes up and he's just like, "Fuck everybody in this convenience store," and X is in there. So X was like, "What?" So X literally goes outside and just stares at him. He turns behind and just. Whops him right in his shit. White boy turns around, he's just like,
"What the fuck, dude?
Like, why'd you do that?"
Yeah, he was hot.
He just needed one dude. So basically, if somebody's looking for a fight, you like to be the guy to serve him up. Because
it's like, why be a fucking prick? Like, I'm anything but a fucking prick. Like, I do everything with my own motive, you know? Mm-hmm. And I believe anybody that can live without motive is literally the most insane person there is. I believe the person who probably plots on murder or plots on doing crazy things is the least crazy, you know? Mm-hmm. So I'm considered crazy, but I think I'm the least crazy because the man who can just kill a man with no recollection or no thought to it or just make a crazy decision with no plot behind it is literally fucking crazy.
But so you don't think you're crazy because
Because everything comes with thought.
I
probably think more than the average human. Like,
so you don't think you could get just driven to doing something really fucked up in the heat of the moment?
I can, but there's always that one thought. As of now, before I was fucking crazy. Like, ask him. Like, when you think I could tell the story about that faggot I beat up?
Yeah.
Hell yeah, in jail. Yeah, that shit was hilarious.
Let's hear this.
All right, so basically they put me in a room. Like, all right, so they put him in a room with this
first
faggot.
First they put
me
in the room with this nigga.
So
tell him how they put
you.
You
mean an actual gay guy when you say faggot?
Yeah.
Literally.
Oh no, wait. No disrespect to anybody that's homosexual.
But once you try to push it onto me, like, it's a different story.
Here's how
it's problematic.
Yeah.
Faggot's problematic, but trying to rape a heterosexual man also problematic.
Exactly. So here's how I put it. I like what people like. You feel me? If you like guys, then that's by far that's you. You get me? I don't disapprove of it. I approve of it. Like, I believe gay marriage should be legal because any man or any woman should be allowed to make the decision they want.
I'm with you.
Exactly. I am not homosexual. I am not homophobic. So if a homosexual man is around me, I will not act like a fucking prick. You know, I'm not gonna act like a piece of shit and be like, "Oh, he's a faggot. I don't want him."
But if he tries to rape you,
but if
jail,
he tries to rape me, I'm gonna bash his skull.
That to me is where you cross the line.
Exactly.
Yeah. The rape thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Feel me? I've got gay friends. I know gay people. Gay people are cool.
You're in the music industry now. You're gonna meet a lot more. Yeah. They're everywhere. I've heard. I don't know personally, but I've heard. Yeah.
Yeah. Fucking
So gay guy in jail.
All right, so basically they put him in the room. They put him in a room with Ski, and
I got the fuck out of there first quarter. Nigga was sitting in the corner staring at me, right? So I'm like, "Bro, if you keep staring at me, I'm gonna beat your ass, bro, and I'm gonna get another charge for you." And I really not trying to catch another charge because we in here for some dumb shit. We gonna sit like 6 months, go to a different program for some dumb shit. I'm not trying to.
He's an older guy.
He was a little bit older than
us. Oh no, bro. This nigga said he was from France and he was lying.
He was like a compulsive liar.
Italian nigga. But yeah, bro. Anyway, so he's sitting in the corner staring at me. So I'm just banging on the door. I'm like, "Yeah, y'all gotta get me the fuck up out of here." I kept banging on that shit till they let me out. So they put him in my room.
All right, I'm gonna tell you that part. So all right, we're sitting in what's called a horseshoe because it was a tent. It's like it's a young nigga like jail type shit.
Right.
So like we're in a horseshoe.
Y&J.
What'd you say?
Y&J.
Y&J. Shouts out to fucking, what is it? Dog Pound? I love that movie, bro. Dog Pound is fucking awesome.
Yeah, Dog Pound is lit.
Shout out Soulplane.
Soulplane? I fucking hate Soulplane.
I just saw Soulplane for the first time the other day.
Yo, it's so fucking cliche. No, that shit's cliche as fuck. That shit racist.
The airline's called NWA. That's so funny to me.
Y'all assholes. Fuck that movie.
Soulplane.
We're all too hyper. I just drank a bunch of coffee.
Yo, I'm off like this Capri Sun, you feel me? I'm in here sipping.
Yeah.
Aloe water. I got my little iPad on the side.
This is great. This is an awesome interview already.
I appreciate it, bro.
Yeah, we're already killing it.
I appreciate it, bro. Thank you. No, fucking
The gay guy in jail.
The gay guy in jail. That sounds fucking crazy.
All I know is when he came out that room, the gay nigga was bleeding from out the top of his head, bro. And he was just sitting there smiling at me like, I'm looking at this nigga like, damn, bro, already, bro.
What did this guy do to you and what did you do to him?
All right. There's the fake story and then there's a real story. So I'll tell you how it began. Like, it was, they kicked him out his room. He, like, 'cause me and him was in the same room type shit, right? And then they made us move because we switched rooms every two. Was it every two weeks or was it two days?
Every 2 weeks we switched rooms.
Every 2 weeks we switched. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Every 2 weeks we switched rooms because I was in a room with him and Will, and like my face was like recognition type shit within the like the jail. Like my face was good because like I was, like I said, I was quiet. I'm not a pussy or anything.
You
but
mean face as in like your level of respect?
My level of respect,
okay,
literally, because
yeah.
Like I was such a good, like I'm. I'm
you
a good kid.
Shut up over there. Hey.
Hey, shut the fuck up.
Yeah. Keep going.
All right. So basically, like my level of respect for everybody within the jail was like, I wasn't a fucking prick. Mm-hmm. You feel me? Like I wanted everybody to be kosher. I wanted everybody to be calm and like just move as a family type shit. You feel me?
Right.
So I respected the officers. A lot of niggas came in there trying to disrespect the officers. I was never that guy. So they came to me after they kicked him out his room and asked me. If they could put him in my room. And I looked at them and I laughed. And I was like, y'all could put him in my room, but if he does anything I disapprove of, I'm going to kill him. And I'm not going to give you any warning. Like, and I said it just like that. And mm-hmm. I put it on my life. I said it like that. And they was like, all right, that's fine. As long as he don't touch you, you shouldn't have to put your hands on him. And I was like, all right, that's fine. So they put him in my room. First few days, he was straight. Like, he was cool. He read his books. I stayed in my corner. He did his thing. You feel me? He asked me a few questions. That was fine. Like I said, I'm not homophobic. He did his shit, you feel me?
This is like Brokeback Mountain. I can't wait to find out what happens here.
So
it's just got a bad ending to it.
So he was cool. He was cool the first few days. So I would speak to him. Like I would even help him when people would bully him type shit. Cause like if you're a bitch in jail, they beat your ass.
Right.
Yeah. So
offer it.
Yeah. So fucking, all right. So I remember one day he just got sus. Like he was staring at me type shit. He was staring at me throughout the day and like, bro, jail makes you crazy.
Yeah.
Like, I was fucking crazy. Like, ask him. There was days where I'd slam my head on the fucking door for no reason. Like, I just wake up and
just
be like, fuck.
Just because you want to feel something. What the fuck else are you going
to
do? Like, yeah.
And there's crazy people in there.
Yeah.
We had this one kid that would just sit there and listen to the walls and think he's listening to music.
Dead ass.
You're around so many crazy people.
So many crazy people,
it
starts to rub off on you, bro. And, like, I'm talking about, I had a full. Yo, this is before the fucking buzz cut on the side with the dreads on the top. This is before any face tats. Bro, I had a fucking afro, bro.
We were
like, I looked like I Am Sue.
So he
like
probably,
I am Sue
he probably
afro.
Wasn't looking at you like you were hard. Is that what you're
not
saying?
Not type like, shit. Yeah, he looked at me like oh, like, this nigga's cool. You feel me? He's probably right. not. He's probably not the hardest. So he's staring at me type shit. So I'm like, yo, I warned you, and I laugh, and I laugh, because that's all I say.
Right.
I laughed and I said I warned you. So I walked out the room to go take my shower, and I came back in, and I was trying to calm down, kind of be kosher. So I turn around and I see this nigga staring at me while I'm putting on my jumpsuit. You gotta be in a towel in front of the nigga. You have to get naked in front of your friends,
right.
Type shit. So that's why it's better to be in a room with your niggas you fuck with. You feel me? Because
right.
If you get a weirdo, it's uncomfortable.
Yeah.
So I go in the corner by the toilet type shit and put and tie on my jumpsuit, and I don't put it on all the way. I tie it around my waist, and I start beating his face in. Do you want me to be graphic with
yes.
it? I grabbed his face and I put it on the corner type shit, cause we have these like metal slabs type. Well, not metal, it's like concrete, right? Concrete.
Yeah.
It's like concrete slabs like for beds, and then there's like a styrofoam shit on top of it. So I pulled off the styrofoam type shit and I threw his head on the corner and I just started stomping like his jaw in type shit. And then as soon as I did that, I remember I just put his head on the corner and I started stomping on him. And then when I did that, I tried to strangle him. And long story short, I was gonna kill him type shit. Because of what he did, I was naked, bro. Like he was staring at me. You feel me? So I start I'm strangling him, and he's like leaking type shit. And I'm strangling him so he doesn't scream. So I'm strangling him, and I'm about to kill this nigga. You feel me?
Right.
And then luckily, because I wouldn't be here today. I wouldn't be speaking to you. I wouldn't be as far as I was. You feel me? I wouldn't be successful. Luckily, a guard came over. And saw that I was standing over his bed, but he didn't see what I was doing. You feel me? So, amidst the luck, I'm strangling this nigga. You feel me? I'm trying to keep him quiet. Amidst his luck, this nigga screams out, and he hears him. So I've got his blood all over my hands. You feel me? All over my chest, literally.
Yeah, right.
So don't think I'm trying to be cliche or a fucking weirdo when I say this, but I was going crazy.
Yeah.
I smear his blood on my face, on my hands. I got it like in my nails. Like, oh, bro, I have it all over me. You feel me?
War so, paint. That's tight.
Type shit. Like, I was going fucking crazy. So I walk, like, they open it and they see that, like, obviously, because he screamed, they open it. They pull me off. So then I go out and I said, I told y'all I would kill him. I told y'all. And the thing was, like, they respected that. You feel me? Because, like, I told them what I was going to do. Like, it's not like.
You're saying the guards respected it. Yeah.
Because, like, they put me in a room with someone that made me uncomfortable, and I said that was perfectly fine. You feel me? Well, not necessarily uncomfortable, but they put me in a room with a risk.
Right.
Because nobody else wanted to be in a room with him, so they put me in a room with him.
Don't they normally put the gay guys in, like, protective custody or whatever? They just didn't do this here?
There is no protective custody. There's only the hole.
Sleep on the floor, like, in
the He ended up in protective custody.
So you didn't actually get in trouble for doing this to him?
No, because I finessed it.
But I did get in trouble the first day. So what happened was, after I did that, like I said, the guards really, 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 I'm not going to say no names because I'm not a snitchy for me, but, like, the guards really, really, really fucked with me.
Uh-huh.
So they told me, go to the bathroom, wash the blood off your hands. And, bro, I swear, in my face. He said, I swear to God when I say this. He told me, take it off my hands, and my mom is in the visitation. Go see my mom. I went to visitation with blood on my fingernails. My mom saw the blood in my fingernails and asked me, what did you do? She looked at me and asked me, what did you do? Because I just had this smug, like empty look on my face. And I was like, I was like, this nigga, like, there's some gay shit. So I had to beat, like, I cracked his head open type shit.
Yeah.
And I said it just like that. And my mom starts crying. Like, my mom's crying and just, like, is telling me, like, you don't realize that you, if you fuck up in here, they could, because they were trying to direct file me. They wanted me in prison for, like, 5 to 10 years.
For the gun charges. For the shit you were already on, yeah.
Bro, I had on top of an armed burglary, on top of a possession, I had, like, hollow tips in my bullets type shit. I had a gun I wasn't supposed to have at that.
Right.
I was just fucking up, you feel me, with all those charges. So, at anything, if I fucked up in there, they could easily direct file me.
Right.
So, she said that, but basically what I did was I finessed it. No homo when I say this, but I said the nigga tried to grab my ass. Right. That's what I told to the guards, because he was gay, obviously, so it would work in my favor. So I told him that he tried to grab my ass, so I beat his ass, long story short. So what they did was they cut my visitation short, literally. As soon as my mom says, don't you know that they can take you away?
They rushed in and grabbed you?
Cliche as fuck, but they rushed in, grabbed me, and they took me to what is the hole.
Yeah.
And the hole is where you're by your fucking self. You have no mat. It's just a concrete slab.
That shit feels smaller than all the regular cells. It, like, it makes you go crazy, literally. Bro. Yes, you're just sitting there, feel like the walls get smaller, bro.
Nothing, bro. Nothing. Like,
how long were you in there for? You don't even know?
It was the rest of the day, right?
Yeah, it was the rest of the day. That shit can make
because
you go crazy.
Though. I put him in the ER, so they had to keep me in there for, like, the rest of the day type shit. But, like, the guards looked out for me afterwards. But not fucking...
But you say that you don't think you're crazy and you think that you can act, you know, like...
No, I was
crazy. You were crazy back then.
That's this nigga. So recently, I was fucking crazy.
Were you on drugs or were you just a little kid going
I was
crazy.
On a mixture very of recent. Fucking
yeah.
testosterone.
Yeah.
A lot of aggression. I was on drugs. I was just fucking wild.
Hey, but you were fire when you were on drugs.
Fuck yeah. My music was
it was lit, though.
Let's talk about drugs. What kind of drugs were you on? And were you on drugs in jail when you're choking out gay guys?
Low key.
Choking out gay guys? I mean, me and this nigga, like, snorted ibuprofens. Like, we snuck ibuprofens under our tongue. We was craving
drugs,
for a fix, bro. Like, bro, you try being in that shit for a whole fucking month.
We was in there for a month, bro, dealing with some dumbass niggas just trying to fight for
just
no
trying to fight
reason,
for no
crazy
reason.
Ass niggas,
bro. So he's like, "Fuck this, we're trying to get high." You feel me? So, like, yo, like, we told him, "Yo, we got headaches, type shit." So he got ibuprofens, I got ibuprofens, snuck them under our tongue, went back, crushed that shit up. We used to sneak papers from, like, the fucking portables type shit. So, like, yeah, we brought them back to the fucking.
You weren't able to get real drugs in jail, though.
No.
This is where we first formulated, like. Us saying that we were gonna do music together.
Really?
Yeah.
You weren't making music before jail.
I was.
He was.
Okay. A little bit or what?
You want me to just tell the story?
Yeah. Let's talk about the music shit too, not just the brutal assaults.
All right. So how it started was, literally, like, when I was a kid, like I said, I was batshit fucking crazy. I would just fight way too much. I had problems with my mom. My dad wasn't around. I was just lost, literally lost, numb. Like, I just wasn't anywhere, you know. And usually, like, growing up, the kids always are like, oh, I want to be a firefighter, or I want to be the president, or I literally always was my answer. You can ask my mother. I never fucking knew. Like, I had no clue at all. So amongst that, like, just growing up, like, just knowing I didn't know what the fuck I wanted to do, music started to present itself. Because I would listen, like, bro, like, you could look at me and probably think, oh, this nigga, like, maybe, I don't even know what people think when they look at me anymore, you know, but, like, I think, like, people are probably like, oh, this nigga's typical. He probably listens to, like, Lil Wayne or, like, and shouts out to Lil Wayne, all these great artists, you feel me, listens to that typical trap shit. But nah, bro, like, I grew up listening to The Fray, 3 Days Grace, Papa Roach.
Really?
But yeah, bro, like, I was weird. I listened to Blood on the Dance Floor. Like, yeah. Okay. Yeah, I was fucking weird.
But you
bro.
Weren't into rap? You were just into all this sort of, like, screamo bands?
That's where the versatility comes.
Like everything.
Yeah, that's where the versatility comes with me, because I would go from listening to that to Lil Wayne, right, to Tupac, to Biggie, to like, different artists, you know? Like, I came up off, like, a lot of artists. Like, I would go from all of that, like, from rock to fucking rap to literally Japanese fucking instrumentals, like, right, different Japanese songs. Like, I was completely and utterly mesmerized by music.
Where were you finding out about music?
I don't fucking know.
You just stumbled upon shit on YouTube or whatever?
I was just looking shit up on YouTube. I at the fucking time, I had a Kyocera slide up. Like,
oh, okay.
I thought I was fresh, you feel me, with my little square-ass phone, my stickers on my phone type shit.
Yeah.
I remember I had my Razer, Samsung, this type of shit. So, like, bro, like, I just used to download mad music on there. And eventually, I started, like, trying to play guitar, trying to play piano, because I always told my mom, like, music ended up being my thing. So she put me in singing classes for, like, a week. Scratch that. Before I lived with her, where the music really started is because while she couldn't take care of me, she put me on my aunt's. Shouts out to my aunt. Shouts out to my cousin Maya. But yeah, she put me in my aunt put me in fucking what was it? What's that shit called where you sing? It's like chorus.
Choir.
Choir or chorus?
It's not for
it's chorus. Church. Chorus is a class. Chorus.
Chorus is also
no. It was for school.
Choir is in church.
No, yeah. So I was chorus. It was chorus. She had me in chorus and choir.
Wow.
So she, like, when she put me in that, they tried to teach me notes. I hated fucking notes. I hated anything that acquired.
Notes too,
I hated anything that acquired.
I hated notes.
Yeah, I hated anything that acquired, like, feeling like I had to. I hated anything that made me feel dumb.
Right.
Literally. So I wanted to, like, find my own way with these things, you know?
Uh-huh.
So I tried to basically, like, learn it without learning notes, and I did. Like,
right.
So I would, like, I was in choir, ended up getting kicked out because I punched a nigga in his shit. Like, I punched a nigga in his shit while we was literally doing a performance because he kept touching me when we were singing.
You might be, like, some kind of, like, gay heartthrob or something. You got all these gay dudes.
No, He wasn't a gay guy.
Oh, okay.
This guy wasn't gay. No.
But even straight dudes are, like, trying to touch up on you.
You feel me? Because I guess
you
I'm
guys
just,
better not try to pull any funny
I guess
business.
I'm just that pretty. You feel me? Craig told me he likes me. You know, he thinks I'm cute.
Craig?
He told me he was going to rape me, bro. All
right. See,
multiple times.
He's still on the jail shirt.
Yeah.
That's his thing. That's his thing right now.
I plead the fifth.
Do you joke around about suspect like a lot? You would tell Craig Zen that you're going to rape him?
Just funny,
fuck what niggas be talking about. Fuck that thug ass, gangster ass shit. Bro, every nigga crack a gay joke every now and then.
Yeah.
I'll go to my nigga and be like, yo, you sexy, nigga. Like, yo, like, you my love like young thug, nigga.
Yeah.
Yo, you sexy over there, like, son. What? You looking sexy. Yo, son, you looking real sexy. I licked them fucking face tats off your face.
That's your man's?
You got to be really good friends with a guy that's starting with this kind of joke.
Real shit, though. Like, fuck that, like, bro, I'm not a goon, bro. Like, niggas get the wrong, like conception about me. I'm not trying to be a goon. I'm not trying to be hard. I'm not these things.
You just
I'm
have
not
goon tendencies.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I'm not the hardest nigga in the boat. Like, if you get, like, niggas like Tyson, nigga, out, bro. Niggas like Tyson will beat my ass, you
Mike
feel me?
Mike Tyson?
Yeah. Niggas like Tyson, or even the average thug on the street, nigga will beat my ass, you feel me? The one thing that is about me is I stand for what I stand for. So if a nigga comes at me wrong, I'm not going to cower. I'm going to try and beat his ass. And if I know I can't whoop you, I'm going to stab you.
And that's a good point, too, is that having a weapon's always nice. But it's better to get beat up standing up for yourself than to just pussy out
and
run away.
Out and run away. Exactly.
Because then you're going to lose respect in front of so many people.
Exactly.
Whereas even
it's
if,
not
you,
even that,
if
like,
you get beat up by the dude, he'll probably have respect for you afterwards if you fight him like a man.
Yeah, fight him like a man. Yeah. I ain't never been a bitch, you feel me? Like, I'm not the hardest nigga, you feel me? I've never lost a fight. No, I almost lost a fight once when I was in, like, middle school type shit. I lost a round before, like, a nigga, like, got on top of me type shit, but I dug my fucking finger in his nose and, like, broke his nose and, like, dug my hand in his eye type shit. I was always a grimy motherfucker.
Dirty fighter, huh?
I was a dirty fuck.
You ever take karate or anything
Yeah,
like that?
I did. He took karate, I took karate.
Well, that's where they teach you how to fucking break people's eyes, balls.
Bro,
and
I was
everything.
A fuck nigga with that karate shit,
really?
Bro. I would go home and try and beat niggas up, bro. Like, I was a fuck
to
nigga.
To be
bro.
Honest, yeah, bro.
That's why I always wonder when I see that, like, the teaching jujitsu and you watch UFC, like, when you see little kids fight on World Star and shit,
that
and they're
ass,
putting
yeah.
each other in, like, triangle chokes and shit.
It was fucking fucking UFC.
Somebody's gonna die. Yeah.
It was UFC that I always loved. Like, yeah, I always loved UFC, and it always made me want to fight. So now, like the type of nigga I am, like, how do I put it? Like, I'm not, like I said, I'm not a goon. I'm not a thug. I'm not what these niggas like.
Well, why'd you start getting tattoos on your face?
Art. How do I put it? It's like telling a story. Every tattoo on me literally is a story. Okay. I don't have a single pointless tattoo. Literally.
I fuck with you.
So, like, literally what I was trying to do is... Y'all having fun over there?
Yeah.
Yeah?
We're talking about tats.
I want to join the fucking party.
Wi-Fi Sphero just took over this interview. It's Wi-Fi Sphero. Nice to meet you.
No, all right. Fucking tattoos.
Yeah.
About my tattoos, like every tattoo is a story, literally. Like, that's self-explanatory.
Well,
know?
So why does it say Cleopatra across your chest?
It's my mom's name.
Oh, okay.
It was literally about my strive for my mom. Like, I just was after my mom, literally.
Okay.
So it was the first tattoo I wanted. My mom's name and my brother was the first ones I got.
Okay. It says alone above your eyebrow.
Alone.
What's that mean?
You want thorough or you want brief?
Thorough, sure.
All right. Alone is the biggest concept for me, literally. Mm-hmm. Alone is literally my idolization. Because my thing is, whether people think they're alone, whether you're in a relationship, whether you're amongst 1,000 people, you are still alone. Mm-hmm. Because your lies are not known by these other people. Your sins are not known by these other people. Until you confess your sins until amongst another man or upon your God or even the devil or even what you believe in, nobody will completely know you. So no one will ever know if you're being honest. No one will ever know what you want them to know. No one will ever know what you want them to know, how you feel, you know?
Right.
So have you ever got, all right, it's like when a female goes and speaks to her nigga and she's like, oh, and he asks what's wrong and she's like, oh, nothing, you know? And then he's just like, all right, well, I tried. You feel me? That's not the response you want.
Right.
That made you feel alone because this nigga, you feel like this nigga don't care enough to hear what the fuck you're talking about. You feel me?
Uh-huh.
So then you get this feeling of being alone, even though you're in a relationship at that.
Right.
So my thing is, like, I've sinned so much. I've done so much. I've seen so much. And I know what others don't know about me or about this world at that. And it's being alone.
So you feel alone because you don't have anybody who truly understands everything that you've been through?
To some degree.
Yeah.
It's just some things are unexplainable, you know? Some things I can't sit here and talk about because people would think I'm weird or people would think like that I'm crazy, you feel me?
They might already think you're crazy.
Yeah, partially.
And weird.
I'm used to it.
Threatening to rape your friends, that might be considered weird. Brutally murdering a homosexual in jail, some people might think that's crazy. I don't know. I want to know more about the music, though. I want to know, like, when did you actually start making music? Like, when did you actually start going hard with it?
Music. I'll be thorough. All right, so, yeah, like I said, I didn't know what I wanted to do. So one day, after I got out of jail, I told my mom, yo, music. Here's how it went. I got locked up for a year. They sent me to a behavioral correctional, which is, it's a fucking boot camp prison.
Right.
For kids. So they sent me to that shit for like 9 months. I was in there for a year. So they sent me to that, started writing in there because like after, this shit is confusing. All right, I got arrested with him. I dropped my first song before because I don't know where the fuck I was. I think I went to a studio because of my mom or some shit.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote this song called New Slash Flock. It was my absolute first song. Absolute, probably best song as far as storytelling. And then I got locked up. I met him. I started telling, like, and then he knew that I rapped because I was like Facebook famous or some shit at that time. Yeah.
At that time, like,
how are you Facebook famous?
Bro, I really don't know.
I was just jiggy.
All he did was take pictures, bro.
Yo, I used to wear like Diamond Supply. Literally. Like, I was a Tumblr nigga. That's what it was.
You had mad Tumblr followers?
Not necessarily. I had people
not
that
even
would
like
my
photography pictures. Like, I'm talking about like phone selfies.
Yeah.
It's because you're light skinned,
bro. I think so. You feel me? Like, I'm ugly now. Like, it's straight, but like type shit. Like, I was a pretty jit. Like, I was a pretty little jit.
What's a jit exactly?
It's a young nigga. Like, a young nigga.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what
so
I
like,
thought, yeah.
So like, fucking, nah. What was I talking about?
Being a pretty jit.
Oh, yeah. We got locked up. Had a song out. He knew who I was because he was fucking with this bitch. And, like, no disrespect to him. He was fucking with this bitch that was, like, obsessed with me type shit. You feel me?
Oh,
like,
okay.
She was... We're not gonna say no names, but you know who I'm talking about. Like, she was obsessed with me, always talking.
A lot of times they wanna fuck the whole crew, you know?
Yeah, type shit.
Multiple
man.
Jits.
We go through that.
Nah, like, it wasn't ever like a me fucking with her seriously. I just knew
he just knew the bitch, yeah. Like, she wanted to fuck with both of us type shit. But I was like, on Facebook, I was a big attraction for me. Like, niggas, like, knew who I was type shit. So he came up to me when we was locked up. He was like, yo, do you know this bitch named da-da-da-da, you feel me? And I was like, yeah. He's like, yo, that bitch is obsessed with you. She tries to get me to say these things that you say to her. Like, she tries to make all her niggas say that shit type shit. Because I guess she had a fetish for this, what I did type shit. So... feel me?
Shit. I was just trying to fuck the bitch, and she was on this weird shit.
Bro, I ain't even fuck yet.
I swear to God, bro.
Bro, so like, so I'ma fuck that bitch. I'ma fuck, you feel me? I'ma get down.
I have it.
I'ma get down with it. Get down. Yeah. Dead ass. No, fucking. Well, how was it like? Yeah, he came up to me. He was like, yo, this bitch is obsessed with you. And then from there, like, we was fucking cool, bro. Like. From there, like, because I get attached very easily. Like, I'm not going to be, like, to bitches, not so much, but to my friends, like, if I spark with somebody, like, I get attached because, like, I want to build a family. Like I said, I don't even do business with niggas I can't fuck with, you feel me? Like, I'll do business once, and if I can't fuck with you, I'll be like, yo, if I see you in the street, don't shake my hand, you feel me? So, like I'm a very personal person. Like, I take every, like, you can't mix business with pleasure, but I tend to, you feel me?
Right.
Because I'm human.
Yeah.
But, fuck. Yeah, so he came up to me, we sparked it off, you feel me? Then he knew that I rapped, so he asked me to rap, and I was like rapping. He was like, yo, you're just fire. Like, he fucked with me, because I was doing, like, I was on my old school shit. Like, I was on some boom bap type shit. Like, I was a boom bap rapper.
Were you really?
Yeah, bro.
Who were you rapping like?
I sounded like Earl. I sounded like Earl mixed with, like, Biggie, mixed with, like, Pog. Like, if you want me to spit some shit to, like,
yes.
All right.
Wow, Earl comes out.
What song?
Sick.
Hot 97
exclusive.
I got it.
Weird.
Like, fire.
Boy Grimm.
God damn.
I got you.
New York City.
Hot 97 exclusive. Shout out Harlem.
Hey, wait a minute.
Y'all niggas shut the fuck
bring
up. Hold on.
Back.
What's wrong
this
with you?
It's hot.
Right. It was like something else.
Cypher,
like,
don't get gas.
I was like,
Desert Storm.
All right, never mind. Y'all want to rap. I'm going to get off the mic. So I was like, I seen the press. Always being bothered, nevertheless, keeping me out of prison and putting me to the test. They ask me, what is happiness? You write it on a check, or you feel it on the sweat when your dick is in the breast, huh? And then I got one I was like, rack credit and nap of a sack, nigga whose blizzard is raps bigger than men of a pack, brim to the top of a gap, brick, gripping a bust and a whack, niggas try to reply, nigga, what do you choose? Simply irrelevant, cynical evident, please, wrestling evidence, keys, moving when definite soul goes for the president, bleed red for the government, tease, residue swimming in your kettle place, right where your bezel lay, cold blizzardly ghost entity, gold digger. Call me to your friendly cold swinging. Gas, give me your cash. Couldn't be stashed feeling. Dove soldier, the coast rover, the gap. I forgot. I said some shit like that.
He just snapped. Shout out Harlem.
I used to do shit. I used to dead ass do shit like that.
Yo, but was it hard for you to learn to rap like that? Because I feel like a lot of dudes, like,
it's the easiest thing.
They learn how to rap technical as fuck in the beginning.
When you learn how the old heads used to do it,
right?
You only work from there. That's what niggas need to realize. You can't go from point A
trying
to
tap
point,
the table.
Sorry, I'm so sorry about this.
Okay.
You can't go from point A to fucking point Z. That shit is stupid. Like, you can't learn. You can't, like, niggas trying to rap like Keith, niggas trying to rap like Uzi, niggas trying to rap like Yachty, niggas trying to rap like the new age shit. You feel me?
Right.
You can't start from there if you didn't start from that boom bap shit, because literally every rapper does.
So you think it's better to learn how to rap technical or old school or whatever,
exactly,
and then be able
to
find your
own flow
style?
Like, I've seen niggas hit, like, retarded ass flows. Like, I'll tell my homeboys, you feel me? Some of my homeboys can't fucking rap.
Right.
Literally. Some of my homeboys cannot fucking rap.
True fact.
Yeah, I try and tell them all the time, like, yo, this song is not good. Stop.
Yeah.
You feel me? But niggas got their own opinions, you feel me? Like, nigga, if you feel like you can strive for that shit and learn it, eventually then do that.
It's hard because everybody wants to rap.
Everybody wants to fucking rap, yeah.
Yeah. But see, that's interesting you say that, because I feel like, well, so do you feel like, how do you rap now in comparison to the cannabis style raps that you just spit right there?
Diggy Simmons.
Diggy Simmons now?
No, I'm just playing.
I'm going to kill you after this interview.
And rape you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yo, I really don't know what he's talking about.
as of now, like, my thing is, I'm versatile, literally. There is no definition to my raps. Like, my thing is, like, I have no genre. Like, as of now, because I don't have the tools that I want. Bro, if you give me the tools to make what the fuck I want.
What are the tools?
Proper studio, proper engineering, even the people that will sit there and take their work very seriously. And, like, as far as the production, if you give me the tools, I'll be the greatest artist there possibly is.
Really?
Literally.
So you really haven't been in that, like, professional recording environment so far? It's just you and the laptop?
It's been me and the laptop. But, like, I can go to studios whenever the fuck I want. But I want people that have the work ethic that I have. I don't want to work. I want to meet famous producers. I want to meet famous engineers. People who that take their shit seriously and have molded a name for themselves. themselves that actually take their shit seriously.
Right.
Because I don't want to be in a studio with someone that's going to sit there and throw some compression and throw some reverb and think it's a fucking track. That's not a fucking track. Not at all. You got to show the track some love. You feel me? Like, you can't go in the studio thinking you're going to make some mediocre shit and that's okay.
That's why sometimes the underground, like, rawness of the track, like,
makes
distortion,
the track
makes the
genuine.
Track.
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
So when niggas tell me, look, and no disrespect to the person that said this, you gonna know who you are, but some girl was on the phone with me, was like, yo, you need to work on your quality, cause the song Look At Me. But I went and looked at her plays. I'm like, yo, your plays are like 1,000 plays. You feel me? You're trying to I didn't say this to her, but in my head, you feel me? I gotta remain humble because I'm a very humble person. But in my head, I'm like your plays are at 1,000, and my distorted ass song is at 1,000,000.
Right. But so that's the question, though. Do you feel like when you have a song and, like, the vocals are over and it sounds kind of fucked up and the different production quality or whatever, that a lot of people on the underground kind of mess around with stuff like this, is that a personal choice that you made, or do you just feel like that's the aesthetic that you're going
with?
It's
a personal thing, because my ears, I want it to fit my ears, because I know if it sounds crazy to me, it's going to sound crazy to everybody else. Mm-hmm. Because if it sounds fucking lit, because I told him, look, when we dropped our first few hits, when it sounded crazy to us, I knew for a fact to other people that would just hear it, it would sound absolutely fucking insane. And I was always right with that.
Do you feel like your music mostly appeals to the, like, post-Raider Clan type Florida scene? Mm-hmm. Or do you feel is that a lot of your fans?
No.
Let me answer that properly.
Because when you're talking about, like, having lower production quality or whatever, I mean, that's something
production
that
quality.
SGP kind of, like, he was the dude in the beginning doing that. His style, yeah.
Here's how I put it, because niggas probably expected me to come on this and disrespect SGP and be like a fuck-ass boy. He's a bitch-ass, mark-ass, pussy-ass nigga, you feel me? But, like, every nigga get their homage. And I know you're going to watch this because that's the type of nigga you is. Look, you got my respect in the end of the day. You a bitch-ass nigga, but you still got my respect for what you were. You feel me? I got fuck perp tatted on me because the thing is...
On your knuckles?
I got fucked up
tight
right
on his wrist.
I got right on my wrist, bro. Because here's my thing. You have a chance to lead the youth. Right. And when I come for a nigga, I come for his neck. You feel me? You had a chance to lead the youth. Like, all right, if you're the George Washington of the world, or you're the first president of this, you breed this new sound, and you literally have all these fucking children. Because I've seen, bro, I've had little girls come to me wanting to kill themselves, you feel me? And I know there's a possibility, if I don't speak to them, that they're going to kill themselves. Space Ghost Perp is the type of nigga where a little girl will come to him trying to kill themselves, you feel me? He'll probably manipulate them and let them do it. You get me? Uh-huh. I'm the type of person where if I'm going to lead someone, or I'm going to do this shit and people idolize me, I'm going to lead them in the right direction. You feel me? I'm not trying to be a fucking prick.
Right.
You get me? So my thing is, he had all these people behind him. Like, I can easily say that I very much so supported Space Ghost Perp when he first came out. Who did not? Because he had a wave going, you feel me?
Right.
Whatever the fuck he had going on, where he fell out with ASAP and them, shouts out to ASAP, shouts out to even Gaddafi, bro. Like, that beef has nothing to do with me anymore. You feel me?
Definitely.
So, like, man, he had such a pull that I was so proud of him as a person, and just proud of what the fuck he was doing, because he was breeding a sound for the underground which had never, ever, ever made it
different
out.
Different sound.
Like,
yeah,
look,
yeah, yeah.
You know,
respect.
What
totally.
Niggas don't understand, bro, is ASAP ended up on MTV. ASAP ended up on the MTV Awards. ASAP ended up on this, and Perp could have been right there, breeding the sound for Florida.
Right.
And we would have finally had someone that brought Florida to the map. Besides Rick Ross, you feel me? But Rick Ross follows a certain pattern. Mm-hmm. Space Ghost was in his own section.
Right.
He breeded something for the underground. The underground is where niggas like us, you feel me? I'm still an underground rapper. I'm not going to be like, yo, I'm an industry nigga, because I don't have that much pride to be like, yo, I'm an industry nigga. I'm still an underground rapper. I'm still just wondering how I'm going to wake up the next day like the next nigga, you feel me? I'm still wondering what my plan is the next day, you feel me? I'm still doing all of this because I do all this shit myself, you feel me? I still got my niggas by my side, but we still plan on all this shit. I'm a human, you get me? So my thing is, like, nigga, if you got the power and you misuse it, you dead to me.
Right.
You dead to me. If you're the president and you're using your power to fuck people over, you're dead to me.
So it was a no-brainer for you to take part in that Space Ghost diss song?
How I put it? Because it originally didn't even start off as a Space Ghost person diss. Everybody added their own thing into
it. Who was
the
other people on it? I forget.
It's Lofty, 305,
right.
Denzel, me, and my boy right here, my partner.
Yeah, me. I go last.
Yeah.
I'm the last on the song. It originally wasn't a diss track, to be honest. That's why my verse came out.
Because it originally wasn't a diss track, but my thing was, is like, Denzel, like, I don't want to say guided because I don't like to sound like I'm responsible for something. But how do I put it? He didn't want to diss him.
Uh-huh.
And I said, this is a chapter of your life because even the dots on my face, it represents chapters. It's chapter one and chapter two. So my thing is, there's a beginning, there's the peak, and then there's the end. Mm-hmm. You know, the downfall, or to some degree, you can end at top. You get me?
Right.
So he's going through different chapters, and that's what he needs to realize. So when you have this person from your past that has been harassing you for a very long time, because obviously he's a grown-ass man. He can't bully a grown-ass man, you feel me?
Right.
But Denzel is a person that is so passive to where he'll let people fuck him over as far as his name. So everybody had this distinct look on Denzel, like, oh, like, and I don't want to say pussy, but everybody had this distinct, like, oh, hey, you know, that nigga not going to say nothing. That's how Perp was. Uh-huh. Perp was like, oh, that nigga not going to say nothing. He not going to do shit, you feel me? And then I'm in Denzel's squad, you feel me? I'm ULT. I'm still members only. I'm still VR, but I'm in ULT, you feel me? So I can't have my brother, because I call Denzel my brother, I call this nigga my brother, I call all these niggas my brothers, you feel me? Bruno's my brother as well. I can't have this nigga in my section having a nigga trying to bitch him out, right, and knowing that I'm going to let that shit slide because that's not the nigga I am. So I came in and left my mark. I left my mark on that. So I told him, I was like, here's what we're going to do. If you want us on the track, you're going to come for him. You're going to say something, you're going to address it like you should have been did.
Right.
Because you're not going to get over on this until you win.
Uh-huh.
You can't settle for a tie all the time. You can't let the little win.
Don't you think in Denzel's case, he's sitting there looking at it like, I just don't even give a fuck. I'm over this. I'm bigger than he ever was.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
That's exactly what he said.
Bigger than he
was. But see, the thing is, look where it brought us.
Yeah.
Look how much of a buzz Denzel got off of finally shutting Perp the fuck up.
You happy with Denzel's verse? You think that he went in hard enough?
I think I went the hardest on the song.
Uh-huh.
I think I went the hardest on the song, but my thing. You got something to say?
Oh.
No, I don't got nothing to say.
I like Ski's verse.
Hey, right, man. Hey, man.
I like
what?
Verse.
Look, nobody like me because I'm the businessman. You feel me? This nigga get to chill. He get to smoke his dope. And I got to be out here doing all this business, that shit. Man, fuck y'all niggas. No, real shit, though. Like, I feel like I went the hardest just because I came on with such an aggression where it's unignorable. Like, mm-hmm. I like to, like, spark something in your head. Like, whoa. Like, you feel me?
How'd you end up in Denzel's squad? How'd you meet him? Is he the main industry dude that's looked out for you?
Not Curry.
Industry, but that like shit, established.
That shit was
dude.
Weird, bro. Like how
it was real random.
Who's that?
It was random as fuck.
Random as fuck.
How it happened was basically like, all right, I was doing, bro. I was going hard, bro. We was going hard in Broward. You feel me? We was going hard in Broward. We was going hard in Miami. Like, our songs was unignorable.
In,
I
hear the in our city type shit. Yeah.
Right. We was going hard in our city type shit, and we was getting heard. You feel me? Niggas can't. After a while, you can't ignore a nigga. You feel me?
Yeah.
So like, we was going to events, and he kept seeing us. And then we got our brother named Chief, you feel me? Chief Pound, shouts out Chief Pound on Twitter, you feel me? But he basically was watching us, discovering us, you feel me? He was ULT. So we did an event called CD4. Shouts out to Creative District. Y'all probably thought I wasn't going to shout y'all out, but I'm a real nigga. I keep up for the city, you feel me? Fucking, he seen us at CD4, and I rocked that shit. Uh-huh. I rocked that shit. I'm talking about, like, and no, like, let me correct myself. We rocked that shit. We rocked that shit. I'm talking about, like, nigga.
Oh, yeah,
we
turned that shit the fuck up.
We was the face of CD4.
Yeah,
that year.
To be
Creative
honest,
District
bro.
It's like an organized show, you get me, in Miami.
Like,
so if you come to the Miami scene, the underground scene, you'll see them. But
that
that
specific day, Kodak was supposed to perform after us.
Yeah.
And the way we performed and
we got it shut
up,
down.
We shut that shit
That's
down.
That's how well we
so
did.
Much so that Kodak didn't feel like playing after?
No, it wasn't that. We turned up so lit because people were outside waiting for us, you feel me?
Right.
Like, we had fans outside of the gate waiting for
in
us.
In the crowd and
outside. And niggas started freaking out and fighting and type shit because they didn't get to see us.
Right.
So, yeah, man. Like, we turned up so hard that Kodak had to go another day. But
really?
We were the face of that event.
Okay.
So, Chief noticed us and he was bumping our shit. He brought it back, played it to Denzel, and they were bumping our shit. They was bumping our shit for a while. They tried to invite us to a music video. I don't remember. I think I declined. I didn't decline. I said all right the first time. It got canceled.
Yeah, it
then,
got canceled.
And afterward, I think they just decided to like just get to the point. You feel me? And was like, fuck it. We just gonna tell this nigga exactly what we want. It was like, yo, come through. We want to talk to you about music and business. So we came through. Denzel got to the point. He was like, yo, I want you to be in ULT. I looked at Denzel and I told him, I was like, here's my thing. I was like, I don't know you. You don't know me. You're approaching me on a business level. I don't do that.
Yeah.
I have to get to know somebody. Because, like, when niggas say gang shit, and then niggas say squad shit, like, that shit real. Like, when niggas say gang shit, like, it's really gang shit. Like, if a nigga crosses him the wrong way, you feel me, on the street, like, you can ask him, bro. If a nigga come at him wrong, I'm always right there. Like, I'm always going to walk up on a nigga and, like, be right there looking, yeah, you feel me? Because, like, on gang shit, like, a gang moves as in a gang. So you could call members only a gang, you feel me?
You think you might be a little too eager to fight, though?
Eager?
Have you calmed down a little over the years, or are you still at peak eagerness?
I'm always at a peak because of all the shit I've been
through. He's eager for a nigga to fuck up.
To fuck up. That's the thing. I wait for niggas to fuck up because it's like, niggas look at it, bro. Like, I'm not a big nigga, you feel me? So I like when niggas feel like they could get over on me.
It'd be like the little sly shit that niggas throw at you a days that you know it'd be sly shit.
Exactly.
That he don't let pass.
I don't let pass. I say shit, you feel me? Like, oh, I think you thought you was going to come at me like that, you feel me? Like, type shit. Like, I'll say some shit, you feel me? Like,
you'll start the problem before they get a chance to disrespect you too much.
Disrespect me, exactly. Yeah, yeah. So disrespect and respect is a big thing because I don't disrespect anyone.
Right.
I respect everyone. I don't little bro anyone unless you literally are my little brother. You feel me? Like, I don't little bro anyone. I don't come for anybody's ego. I let everybody have their own ego. I let everybody enjoy themselves. I let everybody have their fucking fun.
Right.
When I go on stage, I jump off of the stage into the crowd and perform in the crowd.
I haven't seen you play live yet. You get buck?
I get fucking buck. I'm a bro. Puya and them didn't want me on their tour. Ask Craig why. They
really?
Didn't want me on their bro.
We got our set got shut down. We shared a set.
It was Fort Lauderdale, yeah.
Yeah.
He kicked off the tour?
He grabbed the mic stand. We were pulling people up on stage and shit. They cut the music off.
The venue, not Puya.
Yeah, the venue. Here's how I'll do it. I didn't mean Puya.
Right.
Basically what happened was, like, I performed with them for the last four cities it did.
Florida, yeah.
In Florida. So, I did good, you feel me, I followed the rules the first few cities. But see, my thing is, like, everybody feels like there's a standard you have to meet. Uh-huh. Everybody feels like, oh, you got to follow the rules. I'm not that type of guy. Like, I'm not going to come on your tour and not leave my mark.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to go to this different city and not leave my mark. Whether it's by me doing some crazy shit, whether it's by me speaking the right words, whether it's by me doing something I was supposed to, you know?
Right.
But I'm not going to go anywhere without leaving my mark. Even after this, I would hope that you would see how intelligent I am and that I'm not the typical fucking SoundCloud.
I think you're definitely making your mark. I think people, like, because I had no idea that you were on some crazy-ass shit. Like, you know, not that crazy-ass shit, but I had no idea about the jail time, the fact that you are apparently willing to fight almost everyone besides Mike Tyson on a moment's notice.
No, I'll fade Mike Tyson. You can get that.
He can get these hands. Mike Tyson, come catch this fade. I definitely just didn't know. Like, I appreciate the music, and it's crazy, like, to me how much of a fan base you've gotten so quickly, but I definitely didn't know that you
had
so much personality because you never did like an on-camera interview. But it's crazy though, because I feel like a lot of people, they need the visual component or the interview component to really start to fuck with a dude like
for me.
You don't have any videos.
I shy away from cameras because
you and this guy.
My mom made me insecure, bro. Like, I don't like my face. Like,
really?
I don't think I'm.
You're like a lifelong hot boy. You're like, you're talking about being Facebook famous for being cute.
I was, because when I was a kid, when my mom was around,
right
after she left, like, I had no confidence in myself because my mom was the one who dressed me. My mom was the one who told me that, you know, I looked nice this morning or that I need to go take a shower. Like, my mom was my voice.
Does music give you confidence?
Music has saved my life.
Really?
I've tried to kill myself numerous times. You know?
You tried to kill yourself?
Bro, I got hit by... You remember when I got hit in a car? I got hit by the car? Bro, like, my...
Yeah.
Bro... I'm always going to talk about my ex because my ex and music saved my fucking life. My ex stayed with me as long as she needed to while I was insane and saved me. Because my thing was, like, I lived with my ex for, like, almost a year.
I think so.
And I was literally going insane. Oh, absolutely. Like, she was my safe haven. Like, I would go to her. And, like, in the very beginning, it was perfect. You feel me? Like, she was what I wanted. She was everything for me. And she lied to me about some stupid shit. And then from there, like, I got insecure. Any nigga that say they don't get insecure is lying, you feel me? Like, mm-hmm. I got insecure. I stopped trusting her. And mm-hmm. afterwards, like, it just breeded a whole different
just
madness.
Just ruined the relationship,
it,
huh?
Not even. It ruined me. Mm. It breeded a whole different madness in my head to where I was like, I thought I wasn't enough, you know? I thought I wasn't shit. Like, I was like, oh, you feel me? Like, what does the next nigga have that I don't have? She never cheated on me. She was a great girlfriend, but... You feel me? You're always gonna think that.
Yeah. Because
what do you have that the next nigga don't have? I was broke. I wasn't tall. I wasn't the strongest nigga. I didn't have much going besides my music.
Mm-hmm.
And at that, the way she loved me and the way she showed me love, I literally loved her so much that I wanted her to leave me alone.
Mm-hmm.
So I ruined it just because she loved me, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's not. I regret a lot of decisions I make, but.
You're holding on to this one girl.
Yeah, she stands out to you as the one. Anything she needs. She knows who.
But what's your relationship with her like now?
She hates my guts.
She hates you.
She hates my guts.
But do you think that she actually really does care about you, or she really hates you?
She loves me because look, me and my ex did a blood bond. Like real shit, me and my ex loved each other so much. Wi-Fi looking at me crazy, but me and my ex did a fucking blood bond because we loved each other that much. Like. That's not something you can take away. Like I can feel like if she's ever sad, I can feel it. Like it's weird. Like I swear. Like there's times where if she hits me up, I'll already know what she wants to tell me. Right. You get me? I did a blood bond with her when like a couple months in when I was dating her. I love that girl. Like I still do. You feel me? Like but I'm gonna let her do her. I'm gonna let her have her life, do her life. You feel me?
Yeah. Because what you're gonna be popping off as a rapper, not fucking other girls? Nah. I don't buy it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just broke up with a good one too. Yeah. But you know, I gotta get my freak on. It's a sad fact of life.
So I'm tired. I'm actually, bro. I'm tired of fucking girls, bro.
Yeah.
My I've been dick kind stopped of feeling like that for a too. While, bro.
Yeah, I don't know about that. But no, but okay. This is a question that I gotta know is when your music start popping off on SoundCloud. When you start to get this following going, and like, when did you start to feel like, okay, I gotta keep going with this because I'm making a fucking impact. I'm starting to build a following
as,
here.
As soon as we dropped, here's how I do it. Because basically how it was going is I got locked up. I lost any sort of fame I had. People knew me. People knew me like fuck. But I lost my pull. I lost my pull that I had because everybody starts off with a pull. You feel me? Mm-hmm. My pull was Facebook. Social networking was always a forte for me. I always knew how to social network. I always knew how to publicize things. I always knew how to be a fucking idiot enough to where people would see it. You feel me? It's all a marketing method.
I'm getting a little ignorant on social media to get attention.
Because no one else will do it.
Right.
Because they feel like, oh, you feel me? People can judge me. Why put my information out there?
That's the crazy thing is that, I hate to interrupt, but like it's just when you're real on social media. Like you know, when you see Ian Connor and he's posting this naked chick laying there. And it's like,
yeah.
He's just the one dude who will fucking air it out and show you his real life. And his real life is pretty sick. But when I fucking tweet something that is like my real fucked up thoughts, that shit is hundreds of retweets, you know, because people are scared to win.
Here's my prime fucking motto. What is real will prosper.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What you feel in the night, what you feel in the morning, what you feel midday that you don't think, other people have the same thoughts. You feel alone in this thought, but other people have the same thoughts. And it breeds, and when you display this thought, it breeds a certain amount of comfort
mm-hmm.
within people.
Right.
And people start to feel like, all right, this person understands me. This person is fucking cool. So when I say some shit like, oh, hey, I want to fucking gut myself right now. Hey, I want to jump off this fucking cliff. I saw you and it broke my heart. When I say different things like that, and these people, they want to say these things to that person, but they can't say it because it's been so, like, they've gone through all these things. All right, you feel me? You can't say certain things.
It's your job to speak for the inner animal that people don't want to let out in themselves. And that is what people get out of rappers in a lot of ways. They want to get in a fight with someone and shoot that person, so they listen to Cam'ron talk about doing exactly that.
I am the epitome of the misunderstood.
Right.
I am literally the people that aren't understood.
Right.
I just know other way to say that.
The key to a successful song or a successful meme is to show the thing that everybody knows, but that nobody has said.
The balls to speak.
You know, or nobody has said, or everybody, you know, hasn't really fully, you know.
Exactly.
That's true. Yeah.
That's really how we linked up.
Exactly.
What, memes?
No. Just being real.
Just being honest and open with each other. And like, pretty much just being real. Like when I met him, what was it? We met each other at the Southside Suicide Tour, and I heard about him before he heard about me before, but when we both met each other, you know.
I knew who he was.
Yeah. I was aware of you also, and he had showed appreciation for my music, and so we had, I don't know if he had been watching me, but I had been watching him, and we had a mutual artist that we listened to that, you know, his name's Killstation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Kill's the shit, yeah.
Yeah, Kill's awesome.
He was actually supposed to be here.
He was. Yeah. So we linked up, and we just started talking. And pretty much everything he said in his music and the shit I talk about in my music, you know, I told him that.
Clicked,
exactly. Connected. His pain resonates with mine and that I understand where he's coming from. And so on tour, there was a little bit of, sometimes there was like some hectic shit or some drama. And like me and him, because we felt that we were on tour with those people, we were ready for something to happen. Like we were there
Yeah.
Just the same way he was talking about taking shit really personal.
Yeah.
And not being able to, well, for me, I'm not able to like think about business first. I'm not saying not be able, but it's hard for me because I take the shit so personal. I'm so passionate about it. You know what I mean? That's where we linked up.
So you're saying what? It's hard for you to like play the back, like hard for you to be the fifth guy playing before other people?
I can't. I don't mind because I don't do videos. I haven't done. I don't really even have that many fucking photos on Twitter. You know.
Right.
I hated Instagram as well, but I don't mind being the background guy, but I don't like not being heard, and I don't like taking initiative when I could have. I don't like saying, I wish I could have, you know? Mm-hmm. I don't like saying, oh, fuck, I was in that situation. What could I have done better? I'm going to do what the fuck I want when I want because I'm going to do what I could have while I could have.
But do you feel like that makes you not a team player and that means that you're going to have a hard time getting along with people on tour?
I'm very much so a team player because you only have to tell me once.
Okay.
Because once I make that mistake, I won't do it again.
Okay.
But I couldn't have said I didn't do it.
Right.
You get me? Yeah. So if I make a mistake once, you can't look at this person and be like, oh, fuck, well, he fucked up. You didn't tell me not to.
Right. Yep,
exactly. Just like when we was on tour and we talked about the tour.
So basically,
it wasn't out of disrespect.
Yeah, it wasn't. We were doing. I needed to leave my fucking mark.
Yeah.
Bro, I was going against Puya, Suicide Boys, right. Don Krez, fucking Mikey the Magician, bro, even him.
Yeah.
But you feel me? Like, bro, like, I had to leave my mark. And sure enough, I was memorable.
Right.
Yeah. Because I grabbed mic stands, ran into the crowd, and threw it at people.
Yeah.
I jumped on top of the fucking DJ booth on the side of my arm and hung around and was swinging shit. You feel me? Like,
wait, so did people get mad at you for like causing shit and everything?
Nobody was mad at me.
It was the people at the venue. They shut the music off. And it was when we started pulling people up on stage. They were like, no more people on stage. And then I personally, like, I kept kind of interrogating this shit because it was Southside Suicide Tour. Mm-hmm. So I was like, I had no mic or nothing, and I felt powerless because I didn't want to give those people that worked there the power anymore.
Exactly.
So I was like, Southside Suicide, and we were just doing chants and shit. But my bad to interrupt.
Oh, no, you good, bro. Yeah, I brought y'all niggas for a reason, bro.
Yeah, really, it wasn't like we set out to intentionally get cut off. We was just like, this is our time to shine. Like, we're opening up for them. Bro, we are the little niggas.
Yeah.
At least that's how I felt. Like,
people aren't thinking about how you guys are feeling in that situation.
Exactly.
Though, huh?
Niggas are just like, yo, these niggas is wrong.
Because, well, they're looking at you like, oh, you should be thankful to even be here in the first place.
Exactly.
So just shut the fuck up and do your 10 minutes and go.
And it was like anything that was told to us after we did something wrong didn't happen again. Like, hey, you can't do that. Like, oh, shit, my bad. I didn't know. I wasn't told.
Right.
So, okay, next should be like, oh, y'all can't do that. Okay, bet. Da-da-da-da. But, I mean, the shit was fun. I had.
In the end of the day?
Yeah.
If you have another interview with Puya or Suicide Boys, if you ask them if I'm the most genuine person they met and am I easy to do business with, they will say yes, because I do follow the standard.
Nice.
But when you don't go beyond the standard and tell me, like, yo, you can't be your personality. If when I went on that tour with them, because they asked me to go on that tour, ask anyone to do anything.
Mm-hmm.
When they asked me to come on that tour with them, I told them, all you have to do is be genuine with me. Let me be myself and you be yourself, because I'm trying to connect with you on a mental level rather than just on some, oh, nigga, yeah, we done business together. Yeah, you know, nigga, straight, you feel me? I'm trying to fuck with you, you feel me?
Right.
So, like, when he invited me, I told him, this is my standard, you feel me? You got to be genuine and I'll be genuine. And I want to look at you as a brother as you look at me as a brother, you feel me? I want a nigga to be able to see me on the side of the street getting jumped and jump in that shit.
Right.
You feel me? I don't want
to. I would hope that of all my fans as well. I've always thought about that. If I'm getting beat up in public, if you listen to my podcast, you better fucking get in on it.
You have not rubbed me the wrong way. And I know I'm going to benefit off this. And I don't know if you benefit off this. You feel me? I'm going to benefit off this. You feel me? You helped me. This is helping my career.
Mm.
So if I see anyone jumping you, I would jump in.
What about you just straight up murder someone for me? Is that cool? You don't know them. You don't know what they did to me. I just send you. You shoot them. That's it.
No, that's just like being a dumbass.
That's too much? Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm looking for shooters out there if anybody's there.
I'll stab.
Gabe? Well, he's got the bike. You could roll up on the bike, shoot somebody. You know.
Slide on in the game.
Yeah, but shooters for hire. Hit me up in my DMs if you're a shooter. Yeah. What else do we need to clear up? Because we are deep into this interview. I think it's been a fucking great interview. I had no idea you were going to be this talkative. I'm very happy about it.
No, I'm not a prick here.
No, you're awesome. Yeah, what else do we need to know about you, though? Is there anything else we need to know? Besides the fact that people should go to your SoundCloud and listen to all your music?
Versatility. I have no genre. Like, you'll probably see me drop a fucking song with a country singer. And
okay.
You would never expect that.
Right.
I dropped this song called Violent Valentine Lullaby, and it was more like a... like an indie, like heroin high rock, literally.
Yeah, because you have like some bangers. You have some songs with like crazy production, which is like you screaming. You have some songs that are like real soft that are mostly instrumental. You go in like a million different directions on SoundCloud.
Fuck yeah.
And you delete shit.
Yeah.
Shit that you don't like, you just end up kind of...
If you're a real fan, if I drop a song for 10 minutes, you'll have that shit downloaded.
Download it.
I always leave it downloaded.
Okay. Yep.
Always. You'll take that shit, take it to YouTube, boom.
Is that cool for you, like, to have your fans kind of scrapbooking and putting...
My music is free for a reason. Okay. Until it's on an album, and then I feel like you're disrespecting me by selling my album because I needed money from it.
Right.
Then you're a prick. But if my music is free, you're allowed to download it because I'm doing this purposely for that bond. I don't do this for the money.
Right.
I mean, I do this for the bond and obviously the attention because I need the attention. I need it to mold me as a person. And I fucking love music, you feel me? But do I need to get money off of this? Yes, because it feeds me.
Right.
This is literally what I make all my money from.
Are you looking at this like rap shit? Are you looking at it as a real career? Like,
this is what I'm doing? This is my fucking career.
Right, yeah.
Like, bro, I don't trap. I don't do none of that dumb shit. And I still make a lot of fucking money, you feel me?
Uh-huh.
So, like.
Where's the money come from?
Features, for booking,
right,
business,
different shit with my clothing. Like, for anyone that ordered clothes, it's gonna be to you soon. I got a lot.
I haven't seen the clothing.
Huh?
I want to see the clothing.
You want to see clothing?
I could see it being dope. I ain't gonna show me right now.
I'll show you later.
Show me later. Yeah, I want some shit.
Yeah, that shit's dope. I got you.
Yeah, yeah. Fuck. What? Can you spell the Twitter? Can you tell us like exactly where people should check out your shit online?
XXX. Wait, we're not nearing a close, are we?
Well, we are pretty deep. Yeah, we're an hour and 10 minutes in.
Fuck. Yeah. Let's go longer, bro. I'm enjoying this shit.
We could go around like 5-10 minutes because I got these other kids coming that I got to do after you. But yeah, like, what else you want to talk about?
Fuck. I mean, anything, bro.
You ever fuck a girl and her pussy just smells super bad?
Yo, I fucked a bitch.
I
fucked a bitch on the side of literally like of the bando, like amigo type shit. And I was fucking this bitch, bro. And I smelled her ass, like from like, bro. No, but see, the thing is, wait.
Sign,
no, bro. I was
you're
fuck,
3 feet away.
I was fucking this bitch, bro. And I dead ass thought I stepped in dog shit, so I stopped, bro. Like I stopped mid stroke. You feel me? We're on the side of this bando. I'm stroking this bitch. I'm like stroking this bitch. And
you
I stopped.
Wrap it up.
Hmm?
Wrap it up.
What? Bruh.
Okay. Yeah. Well, let's not talk about it.
Yeah. Yeah. No, but I'm fucking.
He was offended that I asked.
And I smell shit. So I stopped this bitch mid-stroke and I look at my foot and I'm like, yo.
Yo, that nigga said he looked at his foot.
That shit. You know which bitch I'm talking about. I told you this story.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, don't say no names. But no, yeah, I look at my foot and I don't see no shit. And I'm just like, bro, I'm stroking this bitch. So, like, amidst it, I just rub my hand and I'm like, yeah. So I wrap that shit up. Like, I just, like, start stroking this bitch, like, fast and nut and just clear it.
Yeah.
And get the fuck out of there.
I love having sex outdoors.
Hmm?
I love having sex outdoors.
You love having sex outdoors? Hell
it's no. The best.
Hell no.
In some alley or something? That's always the funnest.
No.
Hey,
not in Florida with the mosquitoes
Florida?
And shit, dog.
No, it's exciting, man.
Me and my ex have had sex a lot of places.
Yeah.
Type shit.
Totally understandable.
I mean,
but isn't it cool how I could just bring up like you ever smell a really gross vagina and I just knew you would have a story on deck? That's like everybody can relate to that.
Ask me the craziest thing you can ask me and I'll answer it. Besides murder, I can't answer that question.
Oh jeez, yeah, I'm glad I didn't ask about that then. I don't know. Ask me the craziest thing I could think of. I don't know.
Hey man, big shout out to the Groupie Lust. You know we got Becky in the building. Becky in the building.
You did the Groupie Lust thing, the porn thing, the Fat Nick did.
Of course.
You did it.
Yeah.
Did you fuck or did you just?
Of course.
You
did.
Of course. So people can go watch you fuck.
Of course. I'm gonna have pornos out.
You are. So you're not ashamed. You're a rapper who's not ashamed to actually have sex on camera.
Bro, if my dick is little, somebody likes my dick enough to suck my dick. You feel me?
Is your dick little?
No, it's actually really big. Well, see, my thing is, I got this thing that I call a dagger dick. You can call me Young Dagger Dick, you feel me?
Skinny at the end and really big.
Exactly! See, my thing... Fuck, I'm dying in this bitch. But nah, I got a really long dick, you feel me? Like, my dick's like a good 8, maybe 9, you feel me? I got a really long dick, but it's like really, really skinny and pointy. So like it hits your G spot like right like you feel me hit a nigga up if you wanna come you feel me because I can make you come. I get right to the point you feel me Young Dagger Dick. Young Dagger Dick get right to the point stuff bitch.
But you're saying that you really will do a porno that's tight because like
I've done one that's
really
the thing.
But that has commercially available
soon.
This is a man. Right, there's a lot of porn in Florida.
This is a fucking man right here. Bruno is a fucking man.
You filmed him fuck.
Yeah, of course. That's your man. He is the fucking future, bro. Wow. Bruno is the fucking future, bro.
That's awesome. Shout out to Bruno. That's not a gay name.
Shout out Bruno. Shout out to Becky the groupie. Shout out to Kelly.
Hey, even he's got a grill. The porno filmer's got a grill. What the
fuck? He seen us with the girls, and he had to get one. We had to be fucking shining for me.
I think if I hung out with you guys, I'd have to go get one, too. I feel like
if you hung out with us, you would enjoy us, brother. You would enjoy us, brother, honestly. But no, like, as far as, like, fuck, I mean, I'm enjoying this. I don't even want to cut this off, but, like, as far as, like, knowing anything about me, like, just know if you ever going through anything, like, even you feel me, or anybody, like, as a person, bro, like, I would just hope that people feel like they relate to me enough to where they can speak to me. I feel like I hope, like, and eventually I'm going to get too fucking big to, like, acknowledge everything, but while I can, bro, I'm going to hear you. Like, I'm not an egotistical fucking, I'm insecure as shit. Mm-hmm. You feel me? I'm insecure about my skin pigment. I'm insecure about my face.
Oh, you got a nice light skin color going there.
Hey, man, you think I'm sexy?
Well, I just think it's a good color. It's not too light. It's not too dark.
Calling me sexy? You're sexy.
No, I don't want to know about this dagger dick either.
I like your skin complexion. You kind of sexy. Scary, yeah. No, but like, I'm an insecure person. You feel me? We all have emotions that we don't display. Mm-hmm. That's why I've brought everything down to a minimum. I don't speak too much anymore. I don't try and fight too much anymore. Like, as far as I am now, because I feel like the less I say, is the more people will wonder. Right. So I'm leaving wonder and I'm leaving teasing to do its job. You feel me?
Let your music do the talking, and also the occasional Instagram thirst trap.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. You feel me? I post pics of my dick every now and then. Like,
do you seriously?
Yeah. No. Yes, bro, ask these niggas. Stop, ask my fans, bro. When are you gonna post this?
Probably next week.
Next week?
Yeah.
Fuck, it's gonna take that long.
I got a ton loaded up already.
Fuck, man. All right.
Next Monday.
Next Monday? Yeah, all right, that's clutch. All right. So when y'all see this, it'll be probably like a week after. So yeah. So y'all going to be excited and shit.
So you can have a whole shitload of dick pics already posted that'll be ready for them.
You want to make the picture my dick pic?
Yeah, on YouTube. He's getting me all zooted up. Now I'm going to go post a dick pic too. I'm getting motivated.
Bro, it's not that bad, because then bitches see it and they're like, yo, this nigga's so confident. I wonder what his dick game's like. Bro, I've gotten so many fucking bitches off like just posting my dick.
Really?
And I don't even have the longest dick ever. Like, I have a big dick, but it's not the longest dick ever. You feel me? She gripping my dick like a selfie stick, you feel me?
Yeah. Who is she? No. The selfie stick is like out here. Like,
dead ass.
She grips your dick out here.
Yeah. No, but type shit like, no, like if you, on a real level, if you do listen to my music, and like, I would just hope that people feel like they relate with me enough to where they can talk to me. I support all my fans just as much as they support me, because they put food in my mouth, you feel me?
Yeah.
Without them, I would make no money. Without them, I would not have a career. So you have to be very appreciative of the people around you. Like, I love this nigga, I love this nigga, I love this nigga, I love this nigga, I love this nigga. You feel me? If we build a relationship, I would like to call you my brother. It's a very genuine thing to me. This is beyond an interview. This is me actually speaking to you as a person. Like, I take that very seriously. I want to relate to people.
Right.
I want to bond with people, because I did not have the bond I wanted with my mom.
Right.
So
okay.
I felt very, my dad wasn't around either. You notice I can't even really speak about my dad. My dad got locked up.
Yeah.
I had nobody, bro. After my mom kicked me out, I was depressed. I had bad sleep deprivation. Like, bro, I had fucking sleep paralysis. Like, it was horrible.
Right.
And I had nightmares every day. Like, I've been through a lot, man. I've seen niggas get murked. I've been shot at. Like, I have a bullet grazed on my fucking arm. Like, bro, like,
what's that thing on your elbow right there, too? Elbow? Is that a bullet?
No, I slammed a nigga on his shit. Like, shouts out to high school, you feel me?
Ooh.
But no, I slammed a nigga on his shit type shit. Like, some people remember this, like, if locals and shit. But, like, basically, like, my boy was fitting type shit. They was trying to jump him. So, I picked out, because, like, the other nigga I knew, because he was my dog. So, I was like, yo, I can't fight you, so I'm going to fight your homeboy. I don't know him. I was like, what's up, nigga? Run up. So, like, he runs up. I pick him up and I run with him, like, in my hands, you feel me? And I slam him on his shit. But thing was, my arm was under him when I slammed him. Uh-huh. So it was literally like a boom, what people call a boom, like a tackle type shit. So, like, as soon as I go down, all the down here comes off to up here, and it's like deep as fuck. And I just start beating his shit in, and like, I just try to choke him out. And then feds pull up, so we had to bucket.
Right. Yeah, that's crazy. Well, hey, if anybody's looking for some good SoundCloud raps or to catch a fade, your man's right here. He's more than ready to hand it over.
What he's forgetting is that they call me Young Dagger Dick. I fuck too. So don't forget that, you feel me? If you're trying to get fucked, you feel me? My service is not that bad.
Hey, man.
I'll go for like $2 an hour.
That's real.
No Genre, but the coolest podcast in the world, available on YouTube, SoundCloud, and iTunes. I feel like everybody who listened to this has probably learned a lot
about X.
And keep an eye on this guy's Twitter because he's going to be posting a lot of really cool exclusive. Hey, and the No Jumper Twitter as well. We're going to be posting some exclusive dick pics. So,
most people probably don't say this, but Adam, if anybody that comes on this fucking show, Adam is a very cool guy. Adam will not make you feel uncomfortable. This was absolutely my first interview, and he made me feel very comfortable. Great guy.
Hey, he's I'm glad that we could.
Oh, other hand.
That's left-handed.
Yeah, that's the fault nigga hand.
Yeah, you got a good handshake, too,
great,
man.
He's a great guy, bro. He's make you feel comfortable.
I like you, too. You're a cool-ass dude.
I appreciate
Craig
it.
Craig Zan, I like you.
Thank you, man.
But no, fuck these guys. Yeah, Ski Mask and Slum Guy.
Ski Mask is fucking
Can we ask him a couple questions? Because he didn't get any time on there.
Yeah, ask him a question. What's good?
Yeah, what you want to talk about?
What you mean? You want to ask me some questions?
What type of bitches you like, though?
Look, I don't like the look he giving me while he asking me this type of question.
I'm just mesmerized by you. Feel me? I be wondering what you be doing on your free time when we're not here.
All right, I think we gotta wrap this interview up. We just raised the time.
It is my birthday.
Sexy.
Is it real?
Whoa! Oh yes! Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Go get.
And happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you.
Oh, yeah. Shout out members only.
Shout out No Jumper. Shout out members only. VR. Very right top.
Rich life. Hey, let's show the head shit before you hug. Boom, 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 boom. That's the head shit.